Great. Great. We're glad to be back. And as Ben said, this is our fifth year. And so for those of you that know how the military works, I now qualify for my silver oak leaf cluster for the fifth appearance. And every year it's been an absolute joy to see you and to feel the commitment you make to our children. Deanie will often remind me there's things as the chairman and his lady that we have to do. I did one of those yesterday, actually. And then there's things we get to do, and we get to spend some time with people like you. And as we kind of come to the end of our career, that's actually the part of it we'll really miss, because we just admire what you do so much. Really briefly, and then I'm going to turn it over to Deanie, and then we're going to bring up a panel of distinguished questioners. But today in history, Chris Christopherson was born. He turned 79. And some of you are old enough to remember Chris Christopherson, but actually he kind of crosses generations. Many of us remember him as a country western singer with Johnny Cash and the group The Highwaymen. Others might remember him as an actor in the Blade movies, as Whistler. And in The Dolphin Tale, actually. I mention him because he's actually a military child. He's the son of an Air Force general. Did pretty good for himself in that way of making a living, entertainment. He described being a military child as magical, privileged, and painful all at the same time. And I think many of us can relate to what that means. He actually commissioned into the Army and volunteered to go to Vietnam, but instead they sent him to West Point to teach English. And while at West Point teaching English, he decided to get out of the military and pursue his career in music. I mention that because I was a captain in the Army at West Point teaching English and decided to stay in, and I've often wondered. No, not really. But I did want to mention that image of painful, privileged, and magical all at the same time, because I think it resonates. Now with that, let me turn it over to Deanie, and then we'll bring those youngsters out here to talk with us.
Okay, well, I'll just reiterate what Marty said. We are thrilled to be back with all of you. And as a mom, thank you for what you do for kids. As we get the privilege to travel around and talk with families and hear their issues, we often can answer with, well, MSEC's working on that, or MSEC has handled that. So you ought to be proud of what you do for all those kids, many of which I'm sure are your own. I wish that MSEC had been there when my kids were little itty bitties, but you know, now we've learned, and I think that's what's important as we keep learning and move on. So thanks for being here. Thanks for what you do. There's kids all over that are thanking you and appreciate what you do, even if you don't know it. So thanks. We'll look forward to our questions from the kids.
Yeah. You're going to bring them in. While they're coming in, when is the raffle? I've been holding on to my ticket. Is there going to be a raffle? I heard there was a raffle. Where's Pam? What happened to the raffle?
Sure.
I was hoping to be part of it. Okay. All right. Don't make eye contact.
They're here.
They're here. So this is a great a group of youngsters, military children, and I think probably the best thing to do is start by having you introduce yourselves, and then I think you're going to ask me the first question.
Yes, ma'am.
So go ahead and introduce yourself.
I'm Caitlin Jensen from Falcon High School in Colorado, and I'm going to be a junior.
I'm Sarah Lippert. I'm from Steilacoom, Washington. I'm going to be a senior next year, and I go to Steilacoom High School.
I'm Marislyn Termeyer. I'm a junior at Rutherford High School at Panama City, Florida.
I'm Raul Rosales, and I'm from Stacy Junior Senior High.
I'm Hunter Hughes. I'm a junior at Falcon High School in Colorado.
How about a round of applause for them, huh? Okay, Caitlin.
Okay, General Dempsey, how do you define your success?
I don't know. Oh, you want me to extrapolate on that?
Yes, please.
Okay. No, it's a great question. And it, you know, it works at a whole bunch of levels. Obviously, the things I'm proud of about myself although, you know, pride is kind of counter to humility, which I think is the greatest virtue of all in senior leaders. But I am proud of being a soldier, and not much more than that, meaning it's not about the, you know, the stars. Although that surprises people sometimes, but it's really not about the stars. It's, you know, I'm proud of being a soldier, I'm proud of being a husband, and I'm proud of being a father.
Do you think failure plays a part in that success?
I don't know if it, did you hear the question? Would you say something to make sure they can hear you?
Yeah, sorry. Do you think that failure plays a part in that success?
Failure plays a part in every success. I mean, you know, life, and you've experienced it already, I'm sure, you know, overcome your own challenges and got back, you know, it's like Chumbawamba. I get knocked down and I get up again, right? But I'm trying to connect to the kids here.
Yes. That might have been their fathers.
Well, look, at their age, you don't want me to break out into Uptown Funk You Up, do you? Don't believe me, just watch. No, look, I mean, it really is true that you kind of measure the path of life in the ability to stumble and, you know, keep on the path. Now, there are some things, and I tell youngsters especially, to include my own kids, being someone who's in high school is about keeping doors open. Every door that you can imagine is open to you right now, until you do something to close it. That's the great thing about being Americans, right? I mean, look, I'm a grandson of four Irish immigrants, grew up in Bayonne, New Jersey. My father was a postman. My mother stocked shelves at a convenience store. And I'm the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. I can tell you, that would not happen anyplace else. So, the doors are open. You just can't close them. But you can stumble. You just can't fall flat on your face. And I'll leave it to your imagination to decide which are stumbles and which are catastrophes. You want to add anything to that?
No.
Oh, you get your own questions? Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm not helping you with yours.
Okay.
You can't cheat in this.
Yeah. Anything else, Caitlin?
That's it for
Thank
now.
You very much. Okay.
Yeah. I actually have a question for Mrs. Dempsey. If you had to start all over again at our age, would you do anything differently?
Not well, counting.
I was just going to say, when I was your age was when I met this guy sitting next to me. So the life that I have led, I would have never in a million years imagined at that age. And now looking back, I would not have changed it. It has been an amazing ride. And so, I honestly don't think I would.
General Dempsey, I have a question for you.
Good.
Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Do you have any mentors?
Oh, of course. I think mentors are an important part of growing up. And, you know, mentoring is a kind of a two-way street, right? You can want somebody to be a mentor. They have to want to be that mentor in return. So I've been blessed that in particular, the military leaders that I have chosen. And by the way, they don't always have to be older than you. I mean, I've got peers who I consider to be mentors. And I've learned a lot from those who have worked for me. But you know, I have military mentors, some of whom are still on active duty, although I am now, for better or worse, the oldest officer on active duty, so it's pretty hard to find somebody older than me to mentor me. But even in, you know, Mike Krzyzewski has become such a great friend and mentor, and I just love the way he carries himself and the confidence, the values. You know, if you're not a Duke fan, you probably don't care for him, frankly. But, you know, it's like being if you're a Yankee fan, you know, you have to live with people from Boston, for example. You know, but mentors can illuminate. They can't actually do it for you. You have to do it for yourself. But they can illuminate ideas that you may not have had the opportunity to think for yourself, and then you take them in. You know, you are the aggregate of the things that impress you and inspire you. And so I'm also not a person who believes you need one mentor. I mean, I think you have to cast your net pretty wide so you can understand how other people have done it, and then decide for yourself how much of each of them will become you, and but ultimately it's you.
Have they impacted your life any time?
Have they what?
Impacted your life.
My life? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, constantly. I get phone calls, sometimes unsolicited, and sometimes I'll reach out. Every week, for sure. I wouldn't say every day, but every week I'll reach out or be reached. And in particular, for example, on things like, I am the only one that can really define for myself this issue of civilian and military relations. And it's challenging. It's challenging any time, but in the information age, trying to stay centered as the senior military leader, but the advisor to the president and the secretary of defense, the mentor of combatant commanders, and the peer of service chiefs, I really have to work to find that center line to make sure that we're providing apolitical, best military advice. And so I'll call up, you know, one of my mentors or a professor at Duke or at UNC who I have a relationship with, and I'll say, how did that go? You know, yesterday's congressional testimony, for example. And they'll say, well, you know, we think you moved a little too close to the shoulder of the road. I haven't talked to them today, so this is not about yesterday. But they'll tell me, you know, you're kind of left or right of the center line, and that's not the political left or the political right, but they help center me, really. And so, yeah, they affect the way I think about my job, actually.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And Mrs. Dempsey,
Hey man, we're proud
it's
of you.
Okay.
Take your time.
In one word, can you describe the life as a wife of a prominent general in our armed forces?
In one word.
In one word.
Ooh, I can help. I'm the English professor, right? I mean, I got this whole vocabulary.
Humbling, I think, might be a good one. To be in this position, it is humbling that you get the opportunity to touch soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines as you travel around. Because of Marty's job, there is some, I do have influence to try to help situations. And so to be given that gift is really humbling, I think, to it's been an honor. There's probably 50 words I could give, not yours probably. But I think if I had to do one, it would be humbling. It's just been such an honor to get to do this. And you're also an ambassador for your country. You know, Marty and I do a lot with our counterparts around the world. And no matter where you go, you know, you're just held in esteem because we represent the United States of America. And you land in that plane that says United States of America, and people are just in awe. They're all out with their cameras taking pictures of it. And it's just pretty neat to know that we've been given this gift to represent our country and all of our service members and to just care about them and do the best we can for them.
Okay. All right, your word was better than mine.
General Dempsey,
yes.
How did you become involved with MSEC, and how are you benefiting from seminars like these?
You know, that's a great question, because when you become... it actually started when I was a chief staff of the Army, and Beth Corelli, I think it was, asked us to come to this thing called MSEC, and I, you know, frankly, I didn't know what it was.
I did.
Yeah, she did. No, I didn't, really. And the way it works for a four-star generally is, you know, you have a meeting in your office, and you walk out, and you say to your aide-de-camp, what's next? I mean, literally, you go from place to place, and you... as you're walking there or driving there, you prepare for that event. I know you think that I took weeks to prepare for tonight or today. Is it night? No.
No.
but it's just it's our lot in life that you kind of, your life is mostly directed for you. So I walk out and I said to the aide, I said, hey, where are we going? He said, we're going to MSEC. I said, where are we going? He said, MSEC. I said, what's an MSEC? I mean, I had no idea. And I got here, and much like happened to me when we went to TAPS the first time, you can't help but fall in love with the organization and and the idea, just the idea that there's a group of people that gather together with sponsors to try to help military children navigate that path I talked about a moment ago. So I haven't missed it since. I mean, it's just one of those things that when I build my, we build our calendar about 6 months out. And when I build my calendar, there's about three or four things that we put on the calendar and we tell the rest of the world to fit itself around it. Now, sometimes the White House is a little bit of a challenge. You know? Although, that's why these morning events are actually a lot easier for me, because they don't really spring into action until early afternoon and well into the evening. But no, seriously, it's just been a real privilege to be part of it. And how has it helped my development? Well, I mean, that was the other half of the question, I think. And the answer is, you can become really isolated as the chairman and his lady, unless you put yourself out there and try to find out what's going on. So, you know, I mean, I learn a lot from the adults in the audience, but I'm going to ask a couple of you a question in a minute, by the way, so I hope you're ready for that.
And Mrs. Dempsey, same question for you. How did you become involved with the MSEC?
Well, I heard about it years ago, actually. I was in Germany at that time called AWAG, American Women's Activities Germany. I think it stood for, it was a crazy acronym. Anyway, there was an MSEC representative there, and so having kids in school, I obviously wanted to learn more about it, and so I did. And so I knew, and then kind of my kids were grown out, and so you kind of get away from it. And then, like Marty said, when we were asked to come back by Beth Corelli and speak, it just renewed that interest and our appreciation of what MSEC does for all of you kids.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Is it my turn?
I get to be.
You've got a real future. I said, is it my turn? She said, if you'd like it to be.
Well, they have more questions.
Do you have more questions?
We do.
Oh, well, go ahead then.
Okay.
I'll be patient.
General Dempsey, what is some advice you would give to anyone interested in joining the United States military?
Advice on joining the military. We are several things. We give young men and women purpose, meaning, and variety. We give them a genuine purpose. You can feel like you're accomplishing something, right? And that you're part of a team. And my instinct is that young men and women in America today, at some level because of electronic devices, are content to sit in the middle of a football field all by themselves with a laptop connected to the world. You know what I mean? They want to be kind of by themselves, but in the virtual world, connected to everybody and everything and all information. What the military does is take that instinct for belonging to something and make it physical. We take it out of the virtual world, and we from the moment you come in, any service, you are part of a team. And that idea is literally drilled into you, and eventually it becomes your own. So that's that. Meaning, you know, there's just no higher meaning than to be willing to protect your fellow citizens. And then variety, you know, there's a notion that the military is this, you know, kind of monolithic, giant, faceless, caringless, or lack of caring organization. It's actually, it nurtures, it has a built-in system of mentoring. And importantly, we change jobs almost constantly. You know, I don't have to tell you, but we've moved 23 times. How many times have you moved?
Once.
What? Is it your father is in the military?
Neither of my parents are actually in the military.
Oh, they're not? Mm-mm. Okay, well, we're going to get you in and move you a lot. Not only do we move you geographically, but we move you from job to job so that you can develop this versatility. And we literally invest in your development from the time you come in till the time you get out. And the last thing I'll tell you is there's no more fair place on the planet than in the military. I mean, we embrace every race, every ethnic group, every religion. We're literally genderless and becoming even more so. And so it's genuinely a place where an Irish immigrant can become the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff.
That's
That's all I got for you.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Before we came here this week, we were all asked to decide on a defining moment that changed us into who we are today and who we will eventually become. And I would like to know if you have a defining moment or moments that kind of made you the man you are today.
Whoa, that's a profound question, young lady.
Thank you.
A good question, actually. You know, a defining moment is tough to pin down, but I will tell you this. There, for about the first, Dini and I have talked about this often. I graduated from West Point. I went there because my mother wanted me to. I had zero, no, really, that is exactly why I went to West Point. My mother wanted me to go. And so I got there and you know, it kind of, as we say, lit my fire, and I got enthusiastic about it. But, you know, Dini and I weren't sure we wanted to spend our entire lives in the military, so I made the promise to her that probably many of you have made to your spouses in the past. I said, well, look, after 5 years, my obligation's over. I'll get out. I'll become a whatever. And then 5 years came, and I said, you know, I was kind of hemming and hawing, and I said, I'd really like to give company command a try. And, you know, the next thing you know, we're on this, you know, slope to 41 years. And but what was fascinating was that I got out to about 18 or 19 years or so, and I was contemplating leaving at 20. And Dini and our kids, we were sitting around a dinner table, and they said, you can't get out. I said, whoa, wait a minute. I thought I was the one keeping us in, you know? And what had happened was, it had flipped, actually, and my wife and children had become just as inspired, or maybe even more inspired. And so, you know, here we are. In fact, that was part of a conversation as my son was struggling about whether to go to West Point or not. He had an appointment to West Point, as well as some really incredible ROTC opportunities, and he went to West Point. It turns out, my son went to West Point, my daughter went to West Point right behind him, and our youngest went to Wake Forest on an ROTC scholarship. So I suppose the profound moment for me was when it became not just my particular passion, but our family's passion. Go ahead.
General Dempsey.
Yeah.
What were your goals that you set out to accomplish when you joined the military?
What were my goals?
Yes, sir.
Were or are?
What were they?
When
I started.
Yes, sir.
Well, when you start West Point, your goal is to survive, frankly. It's a great question, because people will ask me now, you know, what do I have to do to become the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff? You know, a young lieutenant every once in a while will pop that question. And my answer, normally flippantly at first, is the first thing is you shouldn't want to do that. Meaning, it's not because of the job, it's that that's not the right question to be asking, you know, at 22 years of age. The right question to be asking yourself is, what exactly are you trying to do with your life? And in my case, the reason the military was such a great fit is that I found that I had a passion, really, for building teams, and for trying to make the team better than the sum of its parts. So, you know, you take as a platoon leader a 30-man, in those days it was all men, but now of course it's men and women, a 30-man team, and you try to literally make it the best it can be. Not out of some sense of ambition, but because you just want to see that team, you know. One of the things I'm most proud of is the string of proteges that have now, you know, succeeded behind me. And so in terms of legacy, you know, your legacy is not a piece of equipment or a particular job. It's what you've left behind in terms of the commitment that people make to this profession. So that's been the goal, and it just got a little bigger over time. So, you know, it started with I wanted to do the best I could for those 30 men, and now we're trying to figure out how to do the best we can for 2.1 million. And it's a little daunting on occasion, but it's the same goal.
Okay. What support systems were in place to help you achieve this goal?
What support systems?
Yes.
Well, not just because she's sitting next to me, but I think you can't have a you know, you can't have kind of a steady, firm foundation at work and go home unless that foundation is equally solid. In other words, to accomplish the goals that you set for yourself in whatever profession you choose, and I hope you do choose professions, something you can be passionate about. But you have to work equally hard at home in order to make sure that you've got a little balance in your life. And so the first and foremost support system is your family, and always will be your family. And by the way, in 58 days, not that I'm counting when I retire, that's it. I mean, you know, those of you that have been in the military know, you know, there's this wonderful ceremony. We change it, we pass a flag from one officer to the next. He goes off to the officers' club at Fort Myer, Virginia for a reception, and Deanie and I stand there and shake hands, and then all of a sudden, everybody's gone. I mean, literally, everybody's gone. And some of you have experienced this, and you realize, you know, you go from being invited to MSEC to sit on a panel and talk to children and go to the White House Situation Room and appear before Congress. And, you know, when that's done, what you have is your family. You might get invited back if you do well, I suppose. But what you have at that point is your family. Okay, the second thing in the military is we have two, let's call them chains of support. The non-commissioned officer corps, who are fantastic, and probably the only ones that will actually tell the emperor that they have no clothes. I mean, they are brutally honest. They are the standard bearers. They'll tell you, you know, they will compliment you when you're doing well, and they will plant a boot someplace when you're not. And then you have the officer chain of command, which is actually challenged or chartered to make sure you keep getting the right jobs, to put yourself, we like to put junior officers in a position where they can succeed. So those are pretty incredible. Those three pillars, you know, the officer chain of command, the non-commissioned officer chain of command, and your family, provide, you know, a whole bunch of support.
Okay. And what educational skills do you find lacking in young service members?
Lacking?
Yes. Like, what do they not
have? You know, that's a very fair question because I don't want to be judgmental. You know, meaning it's not just youngsters who might have particular gaps in their education. Just as I said about balance in your life with your family, I think you have to balance your education. I'm not one who thinks we should just, probably going to make some people in the audience squirm a bit, but I don't think we should charge down the STEM route, right? You know, it's all science and technology and mathematics, and I don't even know what the E stands for. Engineering, yeah.
Yeah. That's why he's got me here.
Yeah. But nor do I believe that it should just be about the humanities. I mean, especially at your age where you're trying to figure out what interests you and you're trying to build yourself into a well-rounded person athletically or physically, spiritually and intellectually. And I'm an advocate of casting the net pretty wide. Now, one of the things about I've heard said about technology is it makes younger folks kind of a mile wide but only an inch deep. You know, they know a lot about a little, or no, a little about a lot. And so, you know, you'll have to be your own judge of that. I don't want to be judgmental about it. I would just encourage you to learn for life. You're going to get the mandatory education along the way, but it's kind of what you learn in between that will probably make the biggest difference. And I have a little phrase I use with my general officers and admirals is, you know, leaders are readers because they have to keep learning. I don't care what they read. They could read poetry, they could read, you know, they could read foreign policy, they can read humanity, whatever it is. I don't care. But, you know, business books about management and leadership. But they've got to keep reading because you've just got to keep challenging yourself. And I think as long as that occurs, the gaps fill themselves over time. I don't know. You have any thoughts about that? Okay. I hope the mathematics teachers in the audience are not gathering at the exit now, waiting to ambush me. Yeah.
So you're obviously in a very high leadership position, and you should have faced some challenges along the way, hopefully. So can you tell us what some of the biggest challenges that you have faced in your career have been?
The biggest challenge in military is always making sure that when we ask young men and women to go someplace to defend our homeland, to promote our national interests, and put themselves in harm's way, right? I mean, so the biggest challenge is making sure they're ready. It's also the hardest part of the job. I mean, the decision to send young men and women into harm's way cannot be made without the utmost care and consideration. It doesn't mean we have to be reluctant or reticent to use the military, but when we use it, we've got to be confident that it'll achieve the purpose for which we use it. And then inside of that, it's getting them ready, you know, making sure they, it's not a cliche, but we say often, we've got to be and should be the best trained, the best led, and the best equipped force on the planet. And so, you know, at every level, whether I was a second lieutenant or now a four-star general, it's really about making sure that America's sons and daughters who are entrusted to our care are ready for what we're going to ask them to do. And, you know, most of the time we accomplish that task. On occasion, we don't. And it's heartbreaking when you don't. But that's the hardest part of the job.
All right. Thank you.
I'm back.
Well, we have one more question. Well, I have one more question.
Okay.
Okay. What Department of Defense systems of support are working for the benefit of military-connected children?
What Department of Defense systems of support?
Yes.
Yeah, I may have to phone a friend here. I mean, yeah, go ahead.
The policy and Rosemary Williams. I know who heads it, and I can't think of
what.
And family policy. That's the ones that they are definitely connected to kids. And okay. She runs a forum, and she puts out information, and we in turn give her information or issues to be worked.
Now that's the office, and she's the kind of the person that runs the office. But I'll tell you who the support group is for military families are the chiefs of staff of the services. I mean, and their senior enlisted leaders.
And their spouses.
I mean, one of the reasons we travel is to interact with counterparts around the world. But when we travel domestically, my principal purpose is to make sure that we are giving our young airmen, sailors, soldiers, Marines, and Coast Guardsmen what they need. Deanie normally goes off with the spouses and finds out, you know, what's going right, and importantly, what's not going right. And then we get back on the airplane, and I'm trying to fall asleep, and she's wearing me out, you know, yep. Did you know this, and did you know that, and what are we going to do about this, and what are you going to do about that? And but it's good. And then we go back, and we take the staff, and we say, okay, here's some questions we've got. See if you can find answers, and they always do, because everybody really cares. So it's the chain of command. I mean, it's not just cliche. Look at that. There's a big sign there that says 5 minutes. Well, what if I want 6? Okay. But, I mean, again, I'm not here to recruit you, although I would be happy to do so. But when you join the military, what we say in the military is we recruit individuals. So we recruit Caitlin into the military. But we retain families. In other words, we get you as an individual, but then we convince you and your family that it's in your best interest as a family to stay with us. And, you know, we do really well at that. So it is one office, but it's the profession that is the support structure.
Okay.
Okay, we probably have 4 minutes now. Anybody else have any more questions?
Do you have any questions for us?
I probably do. Where did it go? It went from 5 to 2. Whose clock are you on? You're like Greenwich Meridian or something? you know what? With that 2 minutes, I'm not gonna do that to you. What I do want to do is tell you thanks. I mean, it is courageous. We do this all the time. So sitting in front of those people out there comes kind of a second nature to us now. But I'm sure for you it was a little bit frightening. And no, really, maybe not. Maybe some of you are studying theater or something, and you might break out into song, which I'm gonna do right now. Okay, here we go. But you have to stand up and line up here with me. Deanie will educate you. This is aerobic, so we'll get a little blood flowing. I do this every year, and I get invited back, so it must be okay. Despite whoever's running that thing, trying to kick me off the stage, I'm not leaving until I finish this song. You can't make me. It's a little ditty, a little Irish ditty called The Unicorn Song. Anybody ever heard of it? You have? Do you know the motions?
No.
You are going to learn the motions. So here's how the motions go. Ready? Well, there were green alligators and long-necked geese. There were humpy-back camels and chimpanzees. Now, doesn't that look ridiculous? There were cats and rats and elephants, and sure as you're born, the loveliest of all was the unicorn. Okay. A long time ago. We're going to do one verse and one chorus, and then I got to go because the screen said so. A long time ago, when the earth was green, there were more kinds of animals than you've ever seen. They'd run around free when the earth was being born, and the loveliest of all was the unicorn. Well, there were green alligators and long-necked geese. There were humpty-back camels and chimpanzees. There were cats and rats and elephants. And sure as you're born, the loveliest of all was the unicorn. Well done.
Yay.
Ladies and gentlemen, another round of applause for my chorus.
Great job. You guys were great. Thanks.
Thank you. Great question.
Thank you.
Thanks.
You did a great job.
Thanks,
so proud of you.
Thanks. I wish you all the best. Thanks very much. Great questions. Okay, Ben.
Please welcome back to the stage for a special presentation to General and Mrs. Dempsey, General Ben Griffin, joined by MSEC President and CEO Dr. Mary Keller.
So this year, since it's your fifth year, this is a present for Deanie from a special artist from Salado, Texas, who did this for us, a hand-blown purple bowl.
Thank for joint. There you go. Oh, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Oh,
that's
thank
great.
You.
Thank you. The greatest gift we get is to see you all together doing what you're doing. So thanks very much.
Thank you. Thanks so much. I don't want to trip with them.
Joe Dempsey, before you leave, I will tell you, they were wonderful words for children of any age and adults of any age. I want to thank both of you for your service to this nation and the tremendous job you've done in defense of this nation, in support of the military, and again, support of the Military Child Education Coalition. You've been special friends to MSEC, and I know you well, and I just want to, from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much for what you do, not only for military children and military families, but for the armed forces. Thank you,
thanks,
and all the best.
Thank you. Thank you. Until we meet again. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.